Good evening, Sifei, Ikego, Nagishi, Captain Dave Glenister, with me as always, Master Chief Marty King, here to take your ice comments and hopefully give you some answers that may be humorous, but hopefully factual, and give you some news you can use. We get a lot of ice comments, and that's great. So a lot of times we get repeat ones,
yes, sir.
And we will not necessarily go through all of them. Sometimes they are personality-based or personal-based, and we will address the issue, sometimes leave the names out, sometimes we'll put the names in. So, but rest assured, provided you give contact information, we'll get to your answers and push them back to you at least. So if it doesn't get read on the air, it's not that it's not being handled, but hopefully you've left that contact information. So don't have a whole lot to put out since hopefully by the time you see this broadcast, we will have had the Spring Festival or not based on rain and weather. There is no bad weather, only bad clothes. So we are getting into kind of a rainy season. Cherry blossoms are out and about, so hopefully you can go out around Japan and see the cherry blossoms, if not here on base. I used to really enjoy Ikego and the park near Ikego,
yes, sir,
out there when I lived there, because especially that first run kind of by Nikko Tower right down that main strip. You have all the kind of the trees, archway,
yes,
and stuff, and I would hopefully not get run over, and I used to go out there and take a picture of the family kind of looking down the archway, and all pretty neat stuff. Great time in Japan, and there's a lot of festivals, and they celebrate that, so we should too. It's a beautiful place, beautiful country. And so now's your big chance. So get out there, and if the Spring Festival is rained out, I apologize. If you had a great time, good for you. So, it is going to rain a lot. It is going to rain on short notice. So like I said, if you're going to go out and about and go on one of your great adventures there, just make sure you have some rain gear for you and the kids, and don't let it slow you down. Don't look out the window and see a few raindrops and say, we're not going to Tokyo today. Go anyway. Bring your little pack and throw the stuff in there and have a good time. You deserve it. Okay? So, getting right to our comments, this is kind of a karma balancing moment here, and this is from a customer of Subway, and says, after watching an extremely rude customer berate the Subway crew because he didn't like the price of his sandwich.
Really? It's on the sign, sir.
You like the price of a sandwich? As if only there was some other place you could go.
I know.
Maybe to the left or the right.
I don't know.
Okay. Didn't like the price of a sandwich, even though the price is clearly posted. So even the
yes,
person,
sir,
said it. I wanted to write a comment to let you know how amazing they are. And it goes on to say how they eat at Subway every day. And they're always quick, professional, and cheerful. Actually, I tend to hit that thing either right after a movie or something like that. Kind of part of the package deal when I bring my kids out. And I've had a good experience at Subway. So thank you very much for your comment. And the fact that it's inspired by trying to... give a shout out to some people who you think were wrongfully in the firing line of someone's dissatisfaction. Thank you very much for that. This is for the Housing Services Center of Yokosuka. I have a concern regarding the parking spaces for townhouses on Yokosuka base. Well, parking in general, I would say, is very much at a premium on this,
yes,
base.
It is
a factor in whether or not if I approve your waiver to have a second vehicle, in some cases a third. Some people apply to have a motorcycle in addition to those things. It is a factor in why we do not allow everyone to be able to drive on base, particularly our MLCs, our Japanese workforce. We value them to no end. There are probably 7,000 or 8,000 every day that come and work on this base, and they all can't have a car because of the parking. So it is on our mind at all times. Particularly, I used to drive from Ikego about 6 in the morning in order to get a spot I was on 7th Fleet staff, so I go to the Blue Ridge, I walk a long way, and then, at least go have my breakfast or work out or something, all because of parking. So I feel your pain. But anyway, I have a concern regarding parking spaces for townhouses on Yokosuka base. Each resident has a personal parking space and a parking space for their respective guest. That is not true. Okay. And it goes on to, kind of being good and neighborly and how, I guess, one of the neighbors is using their guest parking spot or things like that. Well, the bottom line is, no, you do not have a guest parking spot. You get one. You get one parking spot, and I believe they're all labeled. And if they're not labeled, if they're not labeled, label came off or something, we can address that. And it's almost like a little mini road rage. Ever someone park in your spot?
Oh, yes, sir.
I had a, I was living in Maine. I had someone park in my spot in front of my apartment. And so I just parked, and I shouldn't have done this. Don't do this. I parked right behind him because there's a big parking lot. It was arranged that you could do that. And then that way they had to come get me with a note on my car and apologize to me or something. But I was young and petty back in those days. So as a wiser old man, I encourage you not to do that. But no, you don't have a dedicated guest spot. Those are all first come, first served.
Yes, they are.
Some people do have two cars or a car and a motorcycle or some second vehicle for good reason. And or your guests or whomever or public works when they come to work on something. Those spots are available for anybody. You do not have a designated guest spot. But point well taken, if you don't have your residence address on a spot out there somewhere, then we should take care of that.
Yes, sir.
You deserve to have a spot. And I know coming home at the end of the day, when you got to go park down the block because some chowderhead is in your spot, boy, that's a parking rage, not road rage, I guess. I don't know. Parking lot rage. But, yeah, that's not good for everybody. But, yeah, so you don't have a guest spot. So there's nothing wrong with that. So first come, first serve. But try and work it out with your neighbors, too, and that'll be fine. Okay, this is for the Navy Lodge. Dear management, extreme pleasure. I want to submit this ICE comment to recognize the outstanding service of the front desk staff during a recent stay there. They made it one of the best experiences they had during their travel with the Navy Mobile Training Team. And I want to give a special thanks to General Manager Mr. Brandon Holla. So, yes, very well done. The Navy Lodge does a good job. And we do tend to hear complaints and things like that. And but I tell you, what I do not usually get complaints about, we'll get things about reservations, you know,
yes,
issues or overbookings. Not overbookings, but no room at the inn, so to speak.
Yes, sir.
And those kind of comments. But I will say it is very rare to get a customer service complaint about them. So they really do a good job. And to the point where even when they had two sailors who were on PCS, no more rooms, and but they were checking at the same time, they asked them, hey, are you willing to take a double room and each have room? And these guys said, sure. And so of course, being neighborly and being, you know, kind of good citizens here, they agreed to pair up. But they are willing to work with people, and so they do a good job. So thank you very much for your comment. Appreciate that. Okay, here is one. Which I believe this particular problem is resolved, but I want to read this one because I think it's of value to others. And this is, I'm a Japanese national and I have a baby whose father's in the Navy. So we have a base ID card for the baby so I can get on base services. But when trying to get on the base, I was turned away at the gate. And how do I get services like medical for my baby on base when his father is out to sea? So I think what we have here is a situation where the mother of the child is not a SOFA sponsor dependent. But the child themselves are, the child,
yes,
is. So, and this, it doesn't have to be a situation like this either. It could be, you could be an aunt or an uncle or someone who is staying here on base to help provide, because one of the service members, or sometimes both service members, go out to sea. You know, if you have two seagoing folks, or any dual military couple, there is a child family care plan. And sometimes your plan for care isn't an outsider, you know, the in-laws or your parents or friends, or I even know one gal who brings her brother in, you know, on retainer,
yes,
to do that kind of stuff. And so this was properly answered. This person was calling legal and calling other things. So for the proper way to get access to the base is to apply to become the child's authorized agent. And there's an instruction for that, and it's Fleet Activities 1750.7. And so what you basically do is you apply to become an agent that says, in order to provide care for this child, that is, you know, things, you know, buying things at the commissary or the Navy Exchange related to the care of this person. Okay, then you can apply for this and you'll get a letter and it'll say what you can buy. So you can buy like all kind of baby-related items if it's an infant or child's clothes of a child or food-related stuff. You can't go into the next and start buying stereos and things like that. That is for SOFA-sponsored people. But this letter will give you access to the base and make you the authorized agent. So that is how that happens.
Yes.
So, and it does happen sometimes also. So when folks leave without continued logistic support, like we said, and it happens where you may be married to a Japanese national and you're going back to, we have one actually who's going to Diego Garcia, which is unaccompanied.
Yes, sir.
So they change their residency to Japan, which means they're not SOFA sponsored. They're not really accessed to the base, but they will get a letter like this one, making them authorized agents so they can come on base to provide services for their dependent U.S. Citizen, you know,
yes,
military dependent child. Right. So yes, there is a way to do that. Hopefully, and you got this answer directly, but I want to put that out to everybody else. There is a way to do that. All right. Here's one. You know I loves my budget talk.
Yes, sir.
All right. So prior to sequestration, okay, if anyone out there can tell me what sequestration is, I will buy you a soda. So if you can fully and accurately explain it. Well, basically, I'll go through it a little bit. I don't mean to be cavalier about this thing. This is related to Purdy Gym, how it was open on both Saturday and Sunday from 08 to 1700. This is March 2013. As a result of sequestration actions, it was announced on the facility website in red font. So there's two aspects of this thing. It is the change of the hours in service and the messaging on this particular one. It talks about how the signs are not posted. The hours were curtailed. Yes, they were. And the signs were posted. The website said all that stuff during the change. And now the sequestration is no longer in effect. What is the current explanation for not resuming previous pre-sequestration operating hours? Okay, so I'm not saying sequestration gets a bad rap, or it becomes the lightning rod for all of our budgetary woes. So the issue is sequestration was it's always in effect. It is always a potential. It just became a reality this last budgetary cycle, but it's always out there. As a matter of law, when a budget is not passed and certain things happen. But basically, that is a series of automatic spending cuts that go into place. So it was not just sequestration. Basically, it was, you know, when we submit a budget, we expect we're going to have X number of dollars to spend. And so as a result of either sequestration, continuing resolutions, or all these other things that most of you don't care about, the budget that comes back, regardless of why, it's the one that we were under and got approved, was less. Okay, so when that happens, the enterprise, which is the kind of the overall management of facilities and installations, of which there are 70 installations, Navy installations around the world, there is an operating order that goes into effect that the Commander of Naval Installations Command puts into place that says, thou shalt spend thy money this way. And those things are implemented by the region and by us. And that's basically how Commander Naval Installations Command chose to crack that code. So if you care how much our budget is, the installation side is about $8 billion for those 70 installations, and it's not divided by 70, by the way. There is more and less based on what has to happen in facilities and services and those types of things. But how we spend that money and how we try to recapitalize those things, and recapitalize means we've been deferring maintenance on a lot of things, buildings and other stuff. The fact that the money is now back does not mean the switch goes on. It means there is a lot of things we were not doing, we still have to do. So we are up to 90 hours per week.
Yes, sir.
And we shall not exceed it. We're not allowed to exceed it. And so the fact that the sequestration is no longer the reason the budget is going down does not mean the budget is not going down. The budget is absolutely going down. Some folks have this philosophical question about what does it take to run the United States military? Head scratcher. Don't know. It's unknown. It's absolutely known. It is $450 billion in 2007, plus or minus one standard deviation for all you math people. That is how much it has cost for the last 230 years to run the United States government, or actually the DOD side, the federal government, right, is about that. And we've been above that, and we've been below that. Right now, we are on the high end of that, and so there is a drive amongst those who are packing their calculators that says we should be right there. Now, that's a bit cavalier also. Times have changed. Our systems are more advanced. We have less people but more automation and all those kinds of things. But that is, for some people in the government, that is the target. And so what does that mean? Well, we're above it now. So we are still going in that direction, and everybody knows that. So when we had all these sequestration happens, we put these measures into place. It was a conscious decision to not just reverse all those budgetary decisions, but to try and take a hard look and say what makes sense. Yes, we'll keep these in place. What didn't break and what did break? Those things that broke, we're going to fix those. The fitness centers, the MWR, largely doing a great job still. They didn't break. We're going to leave those. The operating controls will be the same for FY14, which is where we are, fiscal year 14. So that's why. I mean, it's maybe a longer answer than you really care about, but that is really why. So there's a conscious decision made to not restore everything, but to take a hard look at what really suffered, what broke, and what seemed to be doing okay, what can we live with? And so the decision was made to keep the 90 hours for our fitness centers in place. There you go. And why not continuously have the signs and the website stuff? Well, for about half the population here, or maybe a third, I guess, if you're on 3-year orders, it's been a year. And for them, it's not new. It just is what it is, right? So now the word is out there. If you haven't been to the gym in a year, you probably don't care what the hours were. And if you've been going all the time, then you already know. So that is kind of why we haven't kind of kept up that that change and the sign thing. But that's that. So, yeah, the 90 hours a week. And some of the, there's some other permutations of this thing that are out there. The keeping the clothes at the Fleet Gym, where you can check them out, and not necessarily at Purdy Gym to do that because of laundry and other services. And really, it's, you know, we want to service the fleet. The lunchtime get a workout in requirement. You know, it's rather tough on some folks. Hey, there's no excuse. That was why, you know, I'll tell you what, being on 7th Fleet staff, it was my peers that said, hey, man, there is no excuse to not work out. And we go and play racquetball or something because there was no excuse. Because even if you forgot everything, they got it right there. So that was good. That was good. And that's why we've kind of consciously chosen to keep it at Fleet Rec, but not sorry. So, yeah, so there you go. Okay, so not always satisfying, but the answer is the answer. All right, dear CFA, overall, I think the base is pretty safe as far as traffic is concerned. However, there are two crosswalks, Desron Cave and Main Street, where it's difficult to see people entering. Actually, that is not the crosswalk I thought that you were going to say. There's actually one there's over there by Nimitz. Navy
Federal.
The one by Navy, the sign right there, yes. As you cross over by, I guess it's Nimitz?
I think so.
Yes, as you kind of, right where the NAX sign is, that one, and it's the, and a lot of times these cyclists will not get off their bike, make a sharp turn right as you're making that kind of left turn yield towards that thing. That's the one that I have directed my watchful eye towards in terms of street lights and signs and, you know, traffic cops or something. Well, anyway, to this point, the Desron Cave, you know, it's up on Command Hill. And the issue is that there's so many cars parked right next to it that you can't see anything. And I, you know, I would say I almost got clipped, but that's kind of where I kind of run down there too.
Yes, sir.
And I do, I don't walk across the crosswalk. I do sometimes run across the crosswalk right there as I go back back home there. And, yeah, it's tough to see because all those cars jam it up and you end up peeking out there. So, yeah, there is a work request already submitted for yellow striping around the crosswalk of the Desron Cave. Apologize to Desron 15. Folks who may be living the good life with those parking spots, but they may have to go away. Just because, I mean, I agree. That is, yes, you are, but it's kind of like the end of the curb. You know, there is a certain point on every street, a certain distance where no cars are supposed to park because otherwise you can't see the car around the corner. It's a very similar situation at a crosswalk. You're not supposed to be parking across the crosswalk, and folks are supposed to be able to see that. Excuse me. So we'll take a look at that. Now, for the food court, we got to take a look at that. And see those things. Actually, the food court could probably use some restriping anyway. There's a stop sign right there as well. There's yes. A couple of crosswalks, and over time we add them. My threshold for adding a crosswalk is pretty low. My threshold for removing one is pretty high because people can remember it's there. So we will take a look at that. All right. Got a shout out here for an MA2, recognized for the hard work that she does at the exhibitor job for the U.S. Navy. I've had the opportunity to interact with many sailors in the base, but MA2 stands out from the rest. Utmost professionalism she shows while performing her duties is a credit to the Navy. She is one of the ones in our main gauge, cares for her junior MAs, and put effort puts forth. So very good. We passed on to the individual who it is, and we agree with your comments on MA2. So thank you very much. Let's see. The gate guards. CFA Security and Command. That would be us, I guess.
Yes, sir.
All right. I request to know what can be done to reopen the DIA gate. Answer that, nothing. I'll get to the less cavalier comment in a second. I have been a train commuter for a long time, and the DIA gate access saves almost 15 minutes transit time. I checked, and the construction that was the original reason for the gate's closure is nearly completed. It was clearly completed. You're right, it is. I firmly believe there's been much longer backups for cars, especially. Yes. So we all agree, and as I was backpacking my way back from Tower Hills there. Great for plum blossoms, great for chili blossoms. If you happen to go up, it's about 4 miles away. And as I'm approaching the gate, I realize, boy, I really wish that thing was open myself. And it is. It's the a lot of the SRF workers use it. A lot of folks know where Dye Gate is.
MLCs, yeah.
Yeah, and so if you were to walk around the back of Dye Mall, there's a wooden kind of boardwalk, and then there is a pedestrian gate, which is open for limited hours, but it actually is very handy. So I'm happy to talk about this again and again and again because I think it's worthy of noting what's going on out there. So the boardwalk itself got into the situation of disrepair, fell apart, and it came away because, you know, you could not point to who was responsible for it. And if you can't point to who's responsible, probably nobody's responsible. That's a good lesson in life there. So it was fixed by agreement. The SKDB, they're kind of like our, if you think about the Department of Defense, in Japan, it's the Ministry of Defense. They're broken down geographically into these zones where they kind of are the interface between the Ministry of Defense and the populations. Okay, so SKDB, South Kanto Defense Bureau. And so the gate and the boardwalk has all been repaired and fixed. But so it does not fall into disrepair again. There is an issue as to who is going to pay for the maintenance next time. Preventative maintenance, corrective maintenance, all that piece. And so it is a discussion on the government of Japan's side. It is literally on their side of the fence. So I am not allowed to spend one dime on areas that are not under the control of CFE or the Navy or something like that. So these are kind of outside that line. So it can't be us. Even though I would say that, you know, there's always been the discussion, hey, if the Navy could pick up the tab for some of this stuff, or even if, hey, if you could assure you'll have volunteers to sand and scrub this thing like we used to do the old battleship decks, you know, hollystoning.
Yes, right? Sir.
Brooms, yeah. Broom handles. Yeah. For those of you who don't remember, back in the ancient times, yes. The ancient times of the 1990s when we still had battleships, that's what we did. So we can't do that. So the discussions are really between the government of Japan and the owners of the Dye Mall. And they both have a good argument for saying, hey, this will increase your traffic through the Dye Mall. Don't you want this? Well, of course we do. But this is really an interface between the government of Japan and the U.S. Navy. So shouldn't you pay for it? And those dialogues are going on, and we're involved in them, not as a, you know, we're not passively involved. We want this thing open just like everybody else does. And our initial assessment that would be done in January was largely correct. It is, yes, done. But that is the issue. It is who is going to pay for this maintenance, and it can't be us legally. And so it's got to be somebody else, and they have to come to grips with that. And there's a lot of folks, a lot of the MLCs, Japanese nationals that work here, are voicing their opinions, DAIA. So I'm confident that the agreement that there is goodness in having this gate open will not go away. But as it's what we call in the Navy, you can't push a rope. So as I try to push this rope anyway, I'm not entirely sure I'm going to get a lot of traction. But we are engaged. We make it known that our people and particularly the Japanese workers that are part of our organization are the ones that would benefit the most. And try and make that argument, and I don't really have a preference as to who funds it, provided the gate is funded and open and doesn't fall apart again. Yep. That's really the issue. So, and with that, I think we'll take a break here and have something either hilarious or informational in the interim, and then we'll be back in a few minutes.
Shouldn't be a bully because it makes the other person feel bad and it makes them feel like they want to change themselves. That's not right and it shouldn't be happening.
When you bully somebody, they will keep that inside of them for the rest of their life. They will never forget that.
Yokosuka, stop bullying!
Welcome back, Sifei, Ikego, Nagishi, Captain Dave Glenister, Master Chief Marty King, still rambling on incoherently about your ice comments. Hopefully we'll get to a point on some of these things. But we'll jump right back in here. And this one says, this is from the Purdy Fitness Center. This is my second report regarding the excessive use of common area adjacent to the rear entrance of Purdy Fitness Center by parents and their children. And talks about each day during lunch, it's overrun by parents exercising while the young children run around unsupervised. Now, what, the first comment I want to make is, good on you for submitting this again. Because we did tell you last time, I believe, that if you don't get satisfaction or if the problem reoccurs, then please resubmit. Sometimes in life, we will go to people and say, hey, we will try harder, we'll get better about telling parents. And oftentimes, putting your head down and running faster or trying harder, it only lasts for a limited period of time. And so we are looking at a more permanent solution to this thing.
Yes, sir.
And I think, actually, Massey was talking with the director of MWR about this.
Yes, sir. Talked to Mr. Kyle Rodas, our MWR director. And the rear entrance to Purdy Gym is actually where we have a racquetball court closed off with a children's play area and very limited four pieces of cardio equipment. So what MWR is going to do is they're actually going to expand that and put more cardio equipment in there and some other gym equipment as well, which will actually shrink the child care area. However, because of the utilization and the few pieces of equipment we're going to add in there, we'll be able to get more folks in there, because part of the problem of this is there's only so many pieces of equipment. So the other people that use the gym, which it's open to our entire community.
It is. It is indeed.
Because those machines are being used, they tend to use the main cardio room, and then their kids don't have a place to go for the
right
where it's enclosed right for supervision. So we're going to expand that area, and then we're going to monitor it for use and see if we need to take another step from there to actually do some more. But the plan is in works, and I think Kyle Rhodes and John Benningfield, who's our fitness and sports for deployed forces guy, are working on that right now.
Yeah, it's good to reevaluate also. Anytime there's any kind of big, major change in things, and you've got to be careful not to misread the analogy. So when the fleet gets underway, things will change. The population changes dramatically.
Yes.
When school ends, some folks will go on vacations. Other folks will now be enrolled in other sports programs with their youth, and so things will change. So even if it was working great in February, March, April, it's always good to reevaluate that. So we'll make some changes here, and by all means, make a third report if especially if you like it or don't like it or things change. But like I said, putting your head down and running faster, and yeah, we'll try to get better about reminding parents. And there's that whole good citizenry, please keep your tabs on your parents. Yes, we're not babysitters out there. Very few sports or youth organizations are. You know, when the kids aren't behaving, they just got to go. And it's not up to the staff of that either youth organization, MWR, or whatever, coach of that team, to be a disciplinarian. Right? That's not their role. So, but I think hopefully, I am cautiously optimistic that this will at least address the problem.
Yes.
It probably won't eliminate the problem.
A start in the right direction.
Start in the right direction, yeah. And we'll see how that goes. Okay, so this one gives the date, 10 March. My experience on the 1730 shuttle from Narita was horrible. Okay, basically the executive summary is, as a sponsor, picking up a family from the airport to assist their rival, the Navy Lodge, and they approached the bus. They said the young lady who checked us in told me the bus driver would stop at the Navy Lodge. I asked, okay, so there's a little bit of disconnect here as to what happened. Well, not disconnect. We'll get to the end and say what should happen. But basically, they got to PSD. So, you know, this is the Narita shuttle. And it picks people up at the airport. And it goes to PSD. And if the driver does not have anyone scheduled to go to the Navy Lodge, he is done.
Yes.
If he is already scheduled to go to the Navy Lodge, he will go to the Navy Lodge. So whatever happened on this point, the driver was not scheduled to go to the Navy Lodge. So perhaps you had a discussion with the young woman at the desk at Narita before you left, which is the right place to do it.
Yes.
I guess I say a lot. I've been pointing this point out to me. I try to come up with some other word, perhaps. But you had this conversation and believe you communicated with the woman at the desk, but clearly she did not tell it to the driver. And so when the driver arrives at PSD and believes he has no other stops, no other stop at the Navy Lodge, which, as you know, is a good hike. It's not walking distance with luggage. Well, anywhere's walking distance if you have the time. But clearly you don't have the time for this. You have to take a cab or something. And so it took 15 or 20 minutes to try and communicate with the driver, who does not speak English, and very rarely do they. It is not part of the requirements for their job, so it would just be a happy coincidence if they did. And eventually he did take you to the Navy Lodge, it looks like, but he was very upset. The driver was. Right? And I get that, because deviating from a plan for him, you're stressing him out, and he thinks he's going to get in trouble, probably, because he's now doing something in his mind he's not authorized to do. So it's not like he went above and beyond doing a favor, and yes, this did not work out as planned, but I know that you have actually used this service even before this date. And,
yes, sir.
And it went a little better for you.
I used it just returned from Kona Sun leave. Yes, it was cold, but it did have a great time. Thanks for letting me have the leave.
At least you didn't get snowed in there, like a lot of people.
I wrote it just prior, a couple weeks prior to this date, and then I actually wrote it 3 days after this date. And what we're doing now is we have a young lady who runs the DOD desk, and everybody checks in that is going to use the bus services. And that's not just for Yokosuka, it's all of the bus services for the bases. But on my last trip, which was 3 days after this particular trip, not only did when we registered for the bus, did they ask if we needed to go to the Navy Lodge, but when they called us all together to take us out to the bus, they asked the question again, and then once we were all seated on the bus prior to leaving, they asked once again if anyone needed to go to the Navy Lodge. And maybe this is a result of this particular incident, so thanks for bringing it to our attention, but please be sure if you're using our Narita shuttle and you're returning from Narita to Yokosuka, when they take you out to the bus, to ask the whoever is working the DOD help desk at the time to reiterate to the driver, please stop at the lodge. Also, our NAVFAX public work officer has pretty much made sure as well that they will stop at the lodge. So.
Yeah. So there's one comment in here. It says, you know, as we approached the bus, the young lady who checked us in at the bus stop told me the bus driver would stop at the Navy Lodge. I asked her if I need to inform the bus driver, and she said no because he was stopping there. So what may have happened, yes, you should always make sure that they know there are multiple people, because say someone else was going to Navy Lodge, and so she has on her list, and that person doesn't show up or something, then maybe that thing falls off. So yes, absolutely, every time you should make sure that's voiced beforehand. So I suspect it's probably not a result of that, because that your trip happened so soon afterwards. That was the way it happened for you is probably the way it was supposed to happen. But unfortunately, I regret that. Well, I'm glad you got to the Navy Lodge eventually. I'm sorry you had to go through all that pain to do it. Yeah, but the system is designed to help out with that,
yes,
and to take into account whether you're going to Navy Lodge or not. So hopefully it'll function normally from now on. Next one. Is there any good reason or reasons that Chili's does not have Wi-Fi? And please don't say cost. All right, I won't. A few margarita purchases would probably cover a monthly charge. Yeah, they might. You, given your own little box thing, might cover the monthly charge too. But it's not a cost issue, or it could be a cost issue. Businesses are designed to make money. Chili's is an MWR concessionaire. So they don't really have, basically we contract out to them. They come in and do whatever they want. And so we don't have control over their Wi-Fi commitment. But why would you want Wi-Fi at Chili's unless you're going to belly up there and not buy their stuff?
Yes, sir.
As a restaurant, restaurants want turnover. Now, my wife, being from Europe, one of our first complaints about America is how they shovel them out the door as soon as you're done with your meal in restaurants in California and places like that, and a lot of places. I'm from New York, and it's very fast-paced, you know, grab-and-go type of mentality.
Yes,
even if it's a sit-down, it feels like a grab-and-go kind of meal experience. Europeans tend to sit there for 3 hours, and that's why you can never get a reservation, or maybe that's why you eat at 9 o'clock at night. I don't know. But there's no obligation for Chili's to do this because it's up to them. If they want to, they would. But they probably – I wouldn't. I wouldn't do it if I was at Chili's, because I don't want people to sit there on their laptop for 3 hours. I want people coming in there who are going to have a high turnover of food, drink, whatever you're selling, and then be on their way. The other side of this thing, I mean, as CFE and as people who kind of look at the services, it is a very well-used restaurant.
Yes, it is.
So from a business model, there's no reason for them to encourage more customers with Wi-Fi because people are still coming. But also, we want people to be able to use Chili's and continue to use Chili's. And so by providing you an anchor and a reason not to leave for hours and hours, you know, it becomes more of a lounge type thing. So now I acknowledge, hey, you're going to check your iPhone, you're going to do whatever it is. And that's fine while you're waiting for your stuff to arrive, I guess. And perhaps that's what you're talking about. But it's not a kind of like a Starbucks model where people will, you know, drink their, you know, $7 coffee and then another one and another one as they go. So the short answer is we don't have any control over why Chili's does it. If you look at the business model, I probably wouldn't do it just because they have the throughput and they want to keep the throughput. And Wi-Fi kind of encourages people to hang out.
Yes, sir.
I mean, that's my answer. And I didn't use the word cost. Okay, so I am amazed no one in authority stepped in to stop the extremely loud thumping music coming from the bowling alley parking lot all afternoon on Monday. That would be Monday the 17th, St. Patrick's Day proper. And it was loud, obnoxious impression, American impression Yokosuka has of us. No, I don't really think that's the case. I think you may not be a fan of country music or Thompson Square. Actually, who was playing there? As planned, as predicted, it was a rock concert. I like to think it was a rock concert because I'm not a big fan of country western music as much as rock and roll. So and I thought it wasn't in the afternoon. It was really kind of more the early evening.
It was done. I think we wrapped that concert up about 2,100 or so. And all of the community that went out really loved it. Sorry that your tower unit happens to be that close to where we have these large community events outdoors.
Looking at this thing, I'm not even sure it is a tower. I'm looking at this thing. This is my building. Maybe it's an office. Maybe it is a tower. I'm not sure. Yeah, I heard the big thumping, and I actually got out of a youth organizational meeting about 1900, 1930 or so, and we stopped by and rolled the windows down and enjoyed some music for a little bit. Yeah. And then we had to get home, so we had to go on there. But no, everyone had a great time, and that is as designed. Some music is only good loud. No, that's not the reason it's loud, but it was a concert. They are a very talented group of folks that we happened to book before they became exceptionally popular. So we got very kind of lucky with that. They got this USO tour. They did a great job. Thompson Square, they kind of came down, took pictures with everybody. In fact, because of some of those events, the St. Patrick's Day Parade the day before where we used that parking lot, Thompson Square, where we use that parking lot as well, we're actually looking at what would be the level of pain, safety, and difficulty and taking up all the little mini curbs in that parking lot. And there is pain associated because there's this rebar that ties them in. If you were to rip those out, you'd have to patch it. But because that parking lot is also a good spot for a stage and for a venue like that, and those big things become trip hazards. And as my wife will tell you, I know I'm in the right spot when I hear the grinding of my front bumper on that little mini curb. So it's not doing my cars any favors either. So that's just me and my loud, obnoxious American driving, apparently. So, so no one in authority. Actually, I was there listening to it for a little bit. But it was, I thought it actually went pretty well. So I apologize if you're inconvenienced. I had this little discussion with some of the scouts as we talk about citizenship and laws and why they exist and rights and all these other things that to try and get some young men and women to start thinking in a bigger picture, in a bigger world. I stopped by some kids' seminars and stuff like that at the schools and stuff. And so what are laws and why are they there? And for the most part, philosophically, laws are there to balance two people's rights. Okay, so your neighbor has the right to play their music as loud as they want, and you have the right to a good night's sleep. And so a law is put into place that tries to balance those two rights that you have. And so we say you can play your music at a reasonable level till 10 o'clock at night, and then it can't be heard outside your own building. Those kind of things. So in this case, that's why we kind of made sure that things wrapped up in a reasonable hour. But I apologize if it seemed very, very loud. And it was loud. I'm going to lie to you. It was loud. But most folks seem to enjoy it. So again, we can't please everybody. And that's why I wasn't elected. I was appointed. So, no, I'm just kidding. But, yeah, we'll try and do our best to please as many people as we can. But, you know, sometimes you might get inconvenienced. And, you know, next time, yeah, maybe the other Thompson's Square folks will be inconvenienced and karma will see to it that they, you know, something happens to them. I don't know. So, anyway. Not sure if the yellow box where you could rent DVD / Blu-ray is under your responsibility. The machine is not reliable at all. This actually is going to the NEX Yokosuka Video Rental. So actually there is a, it has a building, so there it is. This was taken on by the customer manager. And so they're aware of the issues we're having with the video kiosks and apologize for the inconveniences that you've experienced. And they're working closely with the contractor to try and resolve the issues. And if they don't respond in a positive way, we are looking at other options to permanently fix the problems. That permanent fix might be just rip those things out of there.
Yes, sir.
And put something else in there. I've generally had pretty good success with not with the boxes here, but with other types of, you know, red box.
The, red box back red, in the States.
Right, right. So I was a very skeptical, I would say, at first. So sometimes we have a service or we have a something contracted and it doesn't work out and we vote them off the island and we try and get someone else in here and maybe that's the answer, but we'll try and certainly do our best there because that is very irritating. That kind of stuff happens. Here's one. My children enjoy the Friday homeschool swim and gym classes. Thank you to Joy and Eric for implementing this new program. Please continue to offer it year-round. Thank you. Any thoughts on this, Master Chief?
Yes, sir. Well, we actually this, got about or the next pages. 10. Yes.
Yes. Thank you, Joy and Eric, for stuffing the ballot box, yeah. I think. Or
I having, think we got no, no, yeah. 10 comments on this, and we are going to run it again from April 18th through June 6th. Yeah. So thanks for bringing us up and letting everybody know that this is a great program, and we're glad people are utilizing it. And it is something we're going to keep on the books.
We are going to keep on the books. So I'm just half kidding around. I'm sure that probably someone said, hey, if you have a, if you like it, please put a nice comment in there because we want to make sure the word gets out. Because everything is about balancing our time, our resources, our money. And if we have this, we're obviously not doing something else with our time, our energy, our managerial efforts, if nothing else. But it sounds like it's working out for you. That's homeschool, swim, and gym classes on Friday. And we are looking at doing that. So.
And registration for the next upcoming class actually starts this coming Monday, March 31st. So,
right, which we probably won't air this by then.
Well, yeah.
Snooze, you lose. Yeah. Sorry, you missed out. No, I think the folks
we should
who
have that posted as well. Though,
we should. We do have. I think that's out there already. And hopefully, the a lot of homeschool folks, they do network. Yep. And you actually, as you might know, you can take certain classes at the school. You can involve in youth sports. We have the school liaison officer has all the information. She's got a great website as well, and it's, everything is all linked together in the school's websites. So you can actually, as a homeschooler, you're not just, it's not all or nothing. You can do certain things. But this is one of those services that that we are starting to offer, and I believe that a lot of the homeschoolers kind of network together. So please share that word with folks. When you like these things, you don't like these things, and you have, we've got a bunch of comments here. Good morning. Just a comment on the parking by the vicinity of Pier 9, specifically Perry Avenue and Forest Hall Road. When the Blue Ridge is here, most of these spots are reserved for 7th Fleet and Blue Ridge. Yeah, even though I was on 7th Fleet staff, that never sat well with me since I was not one of those people. But I think the comment here is that there's a concern that when the Blue Ridge is obviously not here, and so Blue Ridge and 7th Fleet is out, the cars are still there. And so are these people parking there in perpetuity instead of using long-term parking? If it is, that is ridiculous. So maybe we'll have to bust out the old... the old traffic lady, chalk on a stick.
Chalk in the vehicles.
Chalk in a vehicle and start checking this out because, this is for the fleet. Parking is at a premium, as we said. And, we may have to put a time limit on that thing. I know, people have duties, so 24 hours may not be the answer, but there certainly has to be something reasonable. That is the same as every naval station. I mean, usually it says, 96 hours was, I think, the limit in Naval Station San Diego. If your car, because there's sometimes you're there all weekend, duty or inspections and things like that, but... yeah, if you're not there, you end up getting towed to someplace they don't even tell you. Probably National City or the Killing Fields outside in Barrio Logan or something. And you're on your own. But, so we'll take a look at that because that is ridiculous. Ships get in the way, leave their cars there. Yeah. That's. Thank you for the comment.
We do have a couple of long-term designated areas for forces of flow.
Yeah, we do. I want to thank you for all the excellent customer service and quality of work done in my townhouse. I've had numerous work orders, including a leaky faucet, heater unit not working, et cetera, and a bunch of other stuff. So Shop 31, Public Works, does a great job, very responsive.
Yep.
I've been on Yokosuka for 2 years. Every time I've had people come to the house to fix something, it's always been a positive experience. That's been my experience as well. And not just here, because now I live on Halsey with the seniors, but also when I was over at Nikago, up in my tower, I had... a new child that just liked to stand on the dishwasher with it open, and eventually the thing started leaking. I mean, you know, I just dimed them out. But, you know, I broke a lot of stuff, and not me personally, but a lot of stuff was broken in my name, on my behalf, and they always have been great. So appreciate Shop 31 to come out fixing that. Okay, here's one. I know I may have to bust I got the 5-minute sign here. I may have to bust that. There's a new traffic safety instruction which has been stuck in routing for probably 2 years now. That is absolutely categorically false.
Yes.
This is I recommend the CO involvement. I'm getting involved right now. So basically what happened was the Good Idea Fairy came along and decided to drop this thing onto 2 years ago.
Yes.
Drop it into the then chief staff officer's lap, and it was not ready for prime time. You know, safety is not only is it everyone's business, there is a whole lot of organizations. So if you want to change, like, some of the safety things, obviously there is safety, there is security, there is public works, there's all kinds of things involved in that. And this thing was just not properly routed and was shot in the head and sent back then. Now, to that point, there have been 7 changes to the safety instructions since 2010.
Yes, sir.
So there's 26 different articles that are controlled by security, safety, command evaluation office, all sort of stuff. So, and they're in Conflict Act instruction 5800.2, blah, 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 blah. So the bottom line is yes. But the comment that goes in here is bicycle safety. Yeah, so the fact that it's in the instruction does not mean people are following it.
That's right.
The problem is not necessarily the instruction. It's some of these, you know, potential future, you know, hospital patients that can't seem to crack the code that they should follow the rules for their own safety.
Yeah.
And so how I decide to do that, I may have to keep to myself. I have some ideas that may be surprising and irritating to those would-be violators. So we'll save that. But no, so this thing, I know, in fact, there's a later on comment in here, which is almost an apology about this. Yes, there is no instruction. So those in the world out there think, oh, there's an instruction out there. The problem is not the instruction, because the instruction, I think, is comprehensive enough to do it.
It is.
And no, instructions don't sit around for 2 years waiting to get chopped. And if you wrote an instruction and wondering what happened to it 6 months later, by all means, you may feel free to say, hey, what happened to that instruction? This goes out to PSSA Shaquille Hernandez, provided prompt and excellent customer service in addressing my concerns and helped me update my personal records. And is a walk-in customer at PSD. So shout out to you. Let's see. I know we're trying to conserve energy and money, but the lack of streetlights in some areas seems too big a risk. It's not that big a risk. I mean, if it is a risk, we'll turn them back on. But I grew up in New York City. Most people know that, or near New York City. But I used to moonlight in my summers in upstate New York as a carpenter on a farm where there is nothing. It's pitch black. So the key is it safe or is it unsafe? So stay on the sidewalks there. And if it really is, having a darkened street, darkness itself is not bad. Okay. So we do keep an eye on traffic. And there are some parts there, Point Gridley Tunnel, where the sidewalks go away and some of those things. So there are obviously some concerns, but the darkness itself is not a problem. So we will take a look at this particular area. And feel free to bring a flashlight with you as well when you go out at night. A lot of folks do, even in Virginia, where I was, because the streetlights are kind of older and they don't really illuminate it very big. You can kind of see them down the block, but sort of walking their dogs and stuff like that. And you kind of have one, if nothing else, you flash it at the car that's coming.
Right.
So it's very handy to do that. So you may want to consider that as well if you feel, especially in some of those parts where you haven't gotten to, where the sidewalks tend to go away towards the tunnels.
Yes, sir. Especially at the end of Gridley.
Yeah. So, all right. This is the last one, I think. And this is actually sent to the CNRJ. It's the region, EyeSight. I would like to make a compliment. I would like to make a complaint. Very different.
Yeah.
Against the Human Resource Office, but they are not listed. So that's an interesting one. If you're going to complain about Human Resource Office, usually probably because you fall under them.
Yep.
Usually strangers or people who don't care don't. So you may feel free to complain to the office itself. But that's the end of the comment. I would like to make a complaint against the Human Resources Office, but they are not listed. And as you know, it's the region HRO.
Yeah.
But we do have the ability to make
complaints.
Anyway.
There are some services on the base that are not specifically listed under the CFA, hey, I want to make a complaint against this specific activity. If you make a generic complaint, we actually have an ICE manager, and if that particular department or tenant command that is not specifically listed, the ICE manager will reach out to them with your specific complaint. receive a response back and post that response back to you if you leave your contact info for a response. But please, if there's something not listed in ICE, even if you choose to use one of the categories that's not even associated, we will get it, and it will get sent to the proper person to make a response for you.
Yeah, and there are different ICE kind of managers. So, like, sometimes things at the hospital, they usually stay within the hospital because they're very good. They have these kiosks there. But sometimes we'll get a complaint or something about that, and we will throw that grenade over the fence into theirs, and the same thing comes to us as well, especially things like parking at the hospital. They're not really hospital things. And so they'll throw them our way for our ICE manager to adjudicate and push those out. So, if you have a comment and it doesn't fit anywhere, just be specific about what your issues are, contact information, and we'll get to it.
Yes, sir.
And I look forward to this HRO comment as they're out there. So anyway, hopefully we had a little bit of fun today. And I hope you've got some news you can use. Springtime's coming. Get out there. Enjoy it.
Yeah.
Enjoy the weather before it gets too hot.
Because this doesn't happen until next week, hope everybody shows up and has a great time, regardless of weather, at the Open Day Spring Festival with all the cherry blossoms.
I know. It's going to be a good event. Yes. Good event. So hopefully it was a good event this day. So take care. We'll see you around the base. All right.